In this video, a high frequency oscillator that works on approximately 20 kilohertz. This is the waveform that's produced. That of course can change due to all kinds of causes. I hope to tell more about that in this video. Anyway, the circuit is here. The complete circuit, and we see here on the right and on the left a Darlington made with two transistors. This is one part of the this is one Darlington, this is the other Darlington, and they are both connected to a coil. The transistors that I use here have good properties for this purpose. When you drive an oscillator, a coil, especially a coil, you must be sure that the transistors to drive that coil can handle a kind of overvoltage, especially on their base. The base of a transistor is NPN transistor is a of PNP or PNP bipolar transistor is the place into we say steer a kind of signal, and then between the collector and the emitter we see that signal amplified. But for say normal transistors there's always a problem with the base voltage. It cannot be too high, otherwise the transistor gets damaged. And here we have the BD139, and a good property of the BD139 is that it has a very high, it can handle a very high base voltage due to the datasheet 80 volts. And I've used here two transistors that I've salvaged out of old components, the 2SC2625. And when you search the datasheet on the internet, you will find all these properties. Say it can handle 10 ampere, 400 volts, and 80 watts. Of course, not at the same time. That's always a problem with data sheets on the internet. For instance, 10 ampere at 400 volts means 4000 watt. So that's unreal anyway. That has everything to do about how you want to make develop a certain circuit. It's a typical switch transistor with a very small switch time, and it can handle a quite high base current. That's always very important. So here you see that circuit laying down on my table, soldered together. And I've used here this coil. That's an old coil out of a computer supply. I don't know where it was made for. But of course, when you make such a circuit like this, the coil here determines all the properties regarding the frequency, the waveform, etc., etc. And of course, also the transistors, they have capacitive effects on the coil. They can have capacitive effects on the coil, etc. I published this circuit in my book, Schematics 1, and you can buy that on the Lulu website. Anyway, in fact we see here the same circuit, a coil tapped in the middle, the voltage, supply voltage goes to the tap. Between tap and ground we have here a capacitor. The aim of that capacitor is to stabilize the voltage somewhat and also to prevent in a certain way, not too much, that the high frequency travels on the power supply lead. And when you want to get much more suppression, mount here a resistor, a power resistor, between this location and that location, say a resistor of say 5 ohms, 10 ohms or whatever, so that this gets a kind of active filter to prevent that a 25 kilohertz or whatever frequency travels on the power supply lead. You see that resistor, in this case, what I'm showing now in this video, there is no resistor here. And here all kinds of ideas, suggestions to use certain transistors. Anyway, the circuit here again, and I have by purpose drawn that in this way. This transistor is visible at the front, so it's laying on its back on the table, and this transistor, the BD139, is mounted in another way. It's kind of reversed. You can see that here. The BD139 has a front and a back. Front side and a back side. This is the front side. This is the back side. And this back side has a kind of metal part here. That has to do with the cooling of that transistor. When you screw it to a kind of, say, copper plate like this, a small piece of aluminum, the heat that is generated in that transistor can flow away to the air. This is also a kind of transformer that you can use in this case. This is a typical high frequency transformer, old school analog television. And these transformers work on 16 kilohertz. The whole construction here is made to have the best, energy put out to the tube, the cathode ray tube of that old television set, on say 16 kilohertz. That's approximately the line frequency of such an old school television, and that drives the cathode ray tube. And you can see here that it is on the secondary side, there is a very, very good typical isolation. The whole coil is immersed in a kind of resin, and here on the top you see the, say, the electrode that normally goes to the top of the cathode ray tube. And I've made an oscilloscope in the past and used this transformer for that purpose. And that's also in one of my books. Anyway, this coil, I don't know where it came from, proves to oscillate on this frequency in this setup. 90 kilohertz or whatever. And it also depends somewhat on the voltage here, 8 volts. And of course the whole circuit takes current. So let's change the voltage somewhat. Of course we see that the output, the oscillation output, gets down. That's normal, of course. And also the frequency changes somewhat. And say that is normal. There is a relation between the current and the voltage that the circuit takes. is used to the frequency that's generated. Completely normal. When you mount here, for instance, other type of coil, and I have many coils here, say a transformer with a not ferrite core, and of course the transformer has in that case have to a tap in the middle. That's a very important. When it doesn't have a tap in the middle, the whole circuit doesn't work. When you use such a transformer, the frequency will be different. Anyway, it's a very say simple circuit, and it surely works, and I can say that it always works, more or less always. And many circuits, oscillator circuits, don't work for whatever reason. I don't know, but anyway. So again, the good properties of the switch transistor that's used here, the good properties of the driver transistor that's used here, the BD139, with its good property of 80 volts base voltage, and here, well, say very, very good properties to be used as a switch transistor. You can find more information on the World Wide Web. And you can use this circuit for all kinds of oscillators. So here, for instance, high voltage out. The ratio between the windings determines the output voltage. Say you have here 10 windings and here 1000 windings. Here 4 volt and 10 divided by 1000 is 100. And then you have here 400 volts. In general. And of course you can here on the secondary side make a rectifier, a diode, one diode, or even a bridge rectifier, and then with a capacitor that of course has to withstand the high voltage, smoothen that higher voltage out. And you can study with your scope. Be careful when you do that. Don't damage your scope. On high voltage sources. For instance, when you have here say 400 volts, many scopes cannot handle that high voltage. And they can easily be damaged. So be very, very careful. Make a voltage divider here, for instance, and use and test the waveform on say 1/100 or 1/10 of the output voltage. That's important. So the circuit again, and at the same time I'm working on this project, the radio receiver for say 80 megahertz up to say 110 megahertz, but I put it aside for this experiment, kind of in between moment.